After Hemispheres, Rush kind of does a little bit of a rethink. Now we're moving into an era where you have post-punk, where bands are starting to really throw a lot of creativity in. And frankly, a lot of post-punk music is pretty complicated stuff. Not complicated so much in the way Rush is complicated, but pretty inaccessible, hard to love. They're all into learning. They're seeing these bands. They're getting into the Police. They're starting to hear a lot of synthesizers, Ultravox and U2. And they're picking up influence. They're liking these bands. Drummers in particular are like that. They like to hear different drummers. Stuart Copeland had an effect on Neil's drumming style. You hear reggae coming into some of the material as well. So you move into a record like Permanent Waves, where they essentially said, let's try to take all of these epic ideas and squeeze them down into something a little more digestible.
And the band began the task of recording a new album, Permanent Waves, by returning home. As a new chapter opened in their career, they abandoned the scene in Britain and relocated to the picturesque setting of Le Studio, nestled in the mountains of Morin Heights, just outside Montreal.
A residential studio, one of the best in North America. And it was a residential studio in the mountains, overlooking a lake. And they had, aside from working a lot in Toronto and in, I think they'd worked a bunch in Wales at Rockfield, they decided, I think partly because of the reputation of the studio, to work at Morin Heights. And I'd done a lot of work with Gentle Giant, and I'd worked with Emerson, Lake and Palmer, and with Yes, or particularly with Steve Howe. So I think they were really interested in my background, and it gave them an opportunity to have Terry take the sort of producer seat and me take on the role of engineering it. So it brought something new to the equation, I think.
Well, the direction of the next album is, it's a definite move not to conceptualize. So there isn't any long conceptual pieces. There is one tune that's about 10 minutes long that is a little story. There's another tune that's about 7 minutes long. It's sort of a description. It's a suite, a descriptive suite. It has a little bit of lyric, but mostly instrumental. And there's about four or five shorter tunes that are all about different things and all combine all kinds of different influences. I'd say the most immediate thing, the most immediate difference on this album is it's very up-tempo. It's very, very positive sounding out.
Does the album have a name yet?
No.
Have a release date?
No.
Have an album cover?
No. Just got the music.
They always used to go to a small studio north of Toronto and spend, you know, like 5 days a week for about a month writing. So they always came prepared. They would have one song that they never intended to play live at the time. They would invariably do something like that was meant that they could indulge a bit more and without any regard to whether they'd be able to perform it. I mean, one of the things that we did that was different when they came to Morin Heights was that we had a inherited tradition of triple tracking every power guitar sound because it gave it a real powerful texture and it was interesting. And so that would affect when you had, like, normally in a sort of rock format, quite often you'll put like one guitar on the left and one guitar on the right. Well, in this case, we'd have three guitars on the left and three on the right, identical sounds that just blend to make one fat sound. And both Permanent Waves and Moving Pictures, the guitars were recorded like that.
Basically, its newness derives from experiments that I guess we've conducted over the last couple of albums through Hemispheres and Farewell to Kings. We were experimenting with a lot of new instruments and sounds and rhythmic approaches and so on. And in a lot of cases, they were experimentation and took us off in varying directions. But this time, we found ways to put all those directions into a single stream. And consequently, I think the album probably has a more direct feel to it.
I think that they were just doing what they do. Neil would be a good case in point about why his drums were sound the way they sound. He wasn't easy to record at that time because he would have his snare very highly tuned, which was for intentional reason, because the way he played, have a real crack to the sound, and the response you get off the drum when you play it, it's much easier to play all those complex articulations. Whereas at the time, we always used to, in the recording world, we were probably hung up on getting the biggest, fattest snare drum sound that you could. So Neil was the kind of drummer that you couldn't really impose upon him on, okay, let's tune this one down and put some tape on the snare drum. It's like, not a chance. There was no question of messing with Neil's drum kit when the question was asked, Neil, do you think you could just try tuning the snare down a bit, you know, so we can have a bit fatter sound? And he was like, no. sounds great just here. So we proceeded to stick a microphone just to, in response to his comment. We had one of these PZM microphones, which is a flat plate of a microphone, and we taped it onto his chest just to it was more of a being bloody minded on our part. Oh, okay, so it sounds great there, so we'll put a mic right there. So we taped this microphone to his chest, and it was in a video, and people were always asking about that, but I don't think we ever really used it or anything. It was just that we did it.
When the sessions concluded, Rush had recorded an album that signalled another step change in the band's growth. Released on New Year's Day 1980, Permanent Waves comprised mostly short, radio-friendly songs that quickly pushed into the top five of both the US and UK album charts.
Because of the fact that Hemispheres took so long to do and took so much out of us, and it was really a draining album to do, that, you know, was sort of enough. And it sort of taken that conceptual thing to its limit for the time being. And we all felt that we'd like to work on shorter pieces and something that wouldn't be that involved.
As players and as performers, they'd reached a certain kind of peak of their ability to play together. And suddenly the short format of the songs, it was the first time they'd intentionally decided, let's see if we can do something that's more concise. I don't think it did it with an intention to get radio play, but I think it wouldn't have been missed by them that if we actually were able to make a song that in sort of 5 minutes or less that's made us happy, at least the radio stations could play it. And I think there's a certain kind of like, because Rush were already quite a known entity, the fact that radio couldn't play it, stuff of theirs because it was too long, probably meant there was an element of finally we can play something that Rush, you know, have done. So they put it on, and at the same time it was more accessible, and it was, you know, so I think that it was just a combination of like the dam sort of suddenly burst.
Radio, we were responding to those changes in the late 70s and working on making our grandiose view of music arrangement and performance into something more concise. And even stylistically, this song was meant to be a metaphor for switching around the radio dial, so it incorporates not only our values of ornate hard rock, but also a punkish vibe in the second verse and a new wave sequencer in the choruses and a reggae bit at the end and so on. So that was part of the thinking of it and part of the performance of it. One of the things that's crucial is here we come in the opening song and you, the drummer, are walking out in front of all these people, and naturally your pulse rate's going to be running a little high. Tempo is the critical concern at the beginning of a show. And one thing that I taught Alex, who happens to start this song, years ago I remember mentioning to him that a trick I had learned was, don't think of the beginning of the song when you count it in, think of the second chorus, because that's a point at which the song should have become well established and you should have gotten into your groove by then. So very often if I'm starting a song, I think of a later point of the song as a point of reference of what the tempo should be. And I've noticed since Alex has been using that, his tempo is flawless on starting this song or others just from using that little trick.
The Spirit of Radio, this is, if not the ultimate example of Rush as a brilliant singles act, which is not something you normally hear about in the context of Rush. But it's true. When Rush want to be, they can be a fantastic singles act. And it is a genius song. It is a song that is literally meant to be about the spirit of radio, about going around listening to music. It is a classic self-referential song. I mean, Pavement would have killed to have write that lyric in terms of something totally self-referential to the idea of working within music and doing something. Art Brut would have killed to do something like that if we want to take it ahead to like a more recent band. But it is something where it's talking about music in an explicitly commercial context and acknowledging both how it both succeeds and fails. You hope for a little integrity, but it's the illusion of integrity. The whole thing is shaped by filthy lucre, by money everywhere. And yet at the same time, it's this great inspiring anthem with the most amazing guitar part that kicks it off in. It just sort of the things that's both deceptively simple and so perfect. And every little bit of the song interlocks.
In the chorus, the invisible airways crackle with light, that vocal line, we decided, let's put a flanger or something like that on the vocal. So we plugged it in on the old console, and for some reason or other, either the sockets on the thing were partly not working properly, and it got plugged in, and you only got what would be half the waveform of the balanced audio signal, which meant it was thin and distorted and flat, and it sounded like somebody tuning in a radio. So if you listen to that, you'll hear behind his voice this like this, and it sounds like shortwave radio being tuned in, which was completely accidental.
The Spirit of Radio gave the band a hit single, charting particularly highly in the UK. And together with the enthusiastic reception given to Permanent Waves, Rush finally achieved a commercial breakthrough. Their popularity was such that they were now able to tour as an arena headline act, selling out the vast auditoriums that were the traditional provinces of rock royalty.
Permanent Waves was released into the environment in Canada as the Canadian music industry was finally beginning to come of age. We had about 10 years of Canadian content rules to that point, and it had been a very difficult 10 years. There had only been maybe half a dozen album-oriented bands that had any sort of international appeal and were not mediocre. Rush was at the head of this class. And with this record and the international breakthrough that they had, you've got to try and imagine the national pride that Rush fans had that our band had finally broken through, not only at home but around the world. So there was a tremendous, you know, puffing of chests at that time.
I guess that was about 1980 or so. People were coming to our concerts that, you know, I don't think they had any idea why they were there, but it was the thing to do that year, to go see Rush. So I think everything doubled for us that year. Twice as many people were coming to see us, twice as many people bought our record, and then with the next record and the next tour, it all went back to normal.